I'm Chris Hogan. I'm a professor of mechanical engineering at the University of Minnesota. I've been at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities campus since 2009. I have a PhD in energy, environmental, and chemical engineering from Washington University in St. Louis. My research focus since graduate school, so since really since 2004, has been in aerosol science and engineering. In addition to my research role, I'm also the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Aerosol Science. This is one of the two main journals, I would say, in the aerosol field, meaning one of the two journals in the world which is solely devoted to the study of aerosols. An aerosol is a suspension of small particles or droplets in a gas. Technically, we're all breathing in an aerosol right now. It's a mixture of oxygen and nitrogen molecules, but there's also small particles within the air that we breathe. So one of the reasons that many people are interested in aerosols is because of their effect on climate and air quality, as well as on human health, because it is what we're breathing in. We will, in my group, develop methods and instruments to study aerosols generally, their size, concentration, and how they move. And in addition to that, we'll look at some positive things you can do with aerosols. So we'll also look at designing things like coating processes that we use with sprays or with particles to make new materials. So really anything and everything you can think of that would involve small particles or droplets in a gas, meaning an aerosol, we'll try and find a way to study it.
I'm Montserrat Torremorell. I'm a faculty member at the College of Veterinary Medicine at the University of Minnesota. I'm a veterinarian by training, but when I came to University of Minnesota a few years ago now, I did my PhD, my graduate work on infectious diseases that affect the pigs. And many of the infectious diseases that affect pigs have to do with viruses that get transmitted through the air. So actually my PhD thesis had to do with understanding transmission of viruses for the most part.
The chemistry of aerosol particles is complex. They can have a variety of chemical composition. But ultimately, we're also dealing with something that is very dilute. Even when it's considered high concentration, there isn't a lot of it. You know, when we look at air, there's certainly nothing we can see unless the concentration of smoke or what we're looking at is very, very high. So we're often dealing with things that are in parts per million or parts per billion type concentrations. That means one little entity out of a million or one little entity out of a billion is what we're interested in. And that's what often makes it complex. There's a lot of different things that can be sources of particles. There's a lot of different reactions particles can undergo, but ultimately they're often in low concentration compared to other things.
So we choose to do the molecule mini test studies. We choose actually three different viruses, two of them being coronaviruses and coronaviruses of that affect the animals. And the third one was an influenza viruses. The reason why we decided to choose surrogate coronaviruses for SARS type 2 were several reasons. One, very important one, it's for safety reasons. If we had to grow SARS type 2 to the volumes and the concentration that we need to perform the studies that we did, that would be very difficult to do in the first place, but also very unsafe. So it's not really desirable to have to grow large concentrations of SARS type 2 and then using that virus for aerosolization. But then the other reason, which I actually think applies to this very importantly, is that most of the coronaviruses that affect people, SARS-2 being one of them, but others, when we look at the history of the coronaviruses that affect people, most of them, if not all of them, come from animals. So they originated in animals. So those viruses actually share many of the same characteristics, physical characteristics, structure, I mean, you name it. They are very similar for some of the things we take in consideration when we do the airborne studies. So it just made sense to use some of these animal coronaviruses to actually be used as a model for SARS type 2. And we use a porcine virus, which is the porcine respiratory coronavirus, which belongs to the alpha group of coronaviruses. We also use a beta coronavirus, which was the bovine coronavirus. And actually, we use the viruses in two different subgroups of the coronaviruses because we wanted to see whether the methods would be effective against coronaviruses within different groups, right? We were trying to be as comprehensive as possible. And then within this beta coronavirus group, that's where SARS type 2 is found. So the bovine coronavirus and the beta and the SARS type 2 coronavirus belong to the same beta coronavirus group. So there are a lot of similarities between them. And the third virus that we choose is influenza virus. My group also works on influenza transmission. And obviously, until recently, influenza was the poster child for the viruses that are airborne. So again, made a lot of sense to try to test the Molekule Mini device against a broad range of viruses to see whether it was effective. Again, different types of viruses with different families and different groups to look at that broad scope of the device.
The type of testing we do derives from the American Society for Heating, Refrigeration, and Air Conditioning Engineers, or ASHRAE, type testings. They have very good regulations on how to do tests for filters and for units to reduce VOC concentration in ducts. And so we adapt those tests to recirculating air purifiers, trying to follow their rules as best we can. So nothing can remove 100% of particles, VOCs, or certainly viruses. And this is why we look at that log reduction metric. You know, log reduction one means 90% removed on a single pass. Log reduction two, 99% removed. Three, just keep adding nines. Eventually you get to a point where it's hard for us to test if a device is any better. We're in our group, where we run into that point is around log reduction of four. Once you get to 99.99%, the virus downstream of the device is often below our limits of detection. We have a hard time detecting anything. So I would say you can get to a point where it's hard to measure, but nothing is 100% effective. We did two types of tests with the Air Mini. The first was to look at its size-dependent particle collection efficiency. So rather than just say that particles are of a certain type, be it pollen or smoke, we actually used size distribution measurement equipment to say, okay, what is the collection efficiency of 1 micrometer particles? What is the collection efficiency of 2 micrometer particles? What is the collection efficiency of all the way down to, you know, 50 nanometer particles with this unit? And so this was a way to really characterize how the filter within it, as well as the whole unit, does in removing particles. So that was test number one. Test number two that we did was then aerosolizing viruses. So these are viable viruses. We looked at three types, a porcine coronavirus, which infects pigs, a bovine coronavirus, which infects cows, and an influenza A, which is a swine flu, but is influenza. We aerosolized these viruses and looked at the concentration of viable viruses, meaning those that can infect in the air, upstream and downstream of the unit. We also then looked for viral RNA in the air, upstream and downstream. So even if the virus isn't viable, is the RNA still there? And then related to that, we did look at, and this is with my collaborators, Professor Matsi Torremorell and Bernard Olson. We looked at the change in viability of the virus on the filter within Molekule Air Mini over time, both with the unit on, with the unit off, and comparing to kind of a blank filter, because the Molekule Air Mini incorporates the filter incorporates a number of different layers, and including a photoelectrochemical oxidation technology in one of the layers. So the MERV 16 is the basis of the filter, meaning that there's a base fiber structure that would meet a MERV 16 rating on its own. I believe there are certainly more components of this filter. One of them I am aware of is the PECO layer, the photoelectrochemical oxidation layer. And that's in contact with a UVA, UVA light source. That means I think the wavelength is in the low 200 nanometer kind of range. And so there's a catalytic reaction that can occur inside this unit, which drives oxidation. And oxidation, for the sense of a virus, should mean inactivation in the sense if you get oxidized, you're probably going to be inactivated. Certainly if there's multiple oxidation events, a virus would be. So the filter is a unique filter, and the MERV 16 part just refers to the base that other things are added onto.
So one study that we did was to inoculate. We inoculated different filters in a lab setting in which we're inoculating the virus directly into the filter. And then we had different types of filter. We had the molecule mini filter that also contained the PECO technology. Then we had a very similar filter without the PECO technology. And then we had what we call control filter, right? Some of the standard HEPA filters that can be found in the industry, which obviously they don't have the PECO technology. So we inoculated those, we ran the tests, you know, we put them back in the device where we let them PECO make its job, and then try to isolate the virus from those filters, from all the sets of filters that we had. And in those cases, we did see that the filter that contained the PECO technology was better at inactivating the viruses compared to the rest of the filters that we test. On the PECO technology, what we saw is a reduction of 2 logs, which was significant compared to what we saw in the other filters. But the inactivation, we could see it fairly quickly after the inoculation of the filters. We saw very quickly 1 log reduction, but during the time of the study, we achieved up to 2 log reduction.
So we were nebulizing viral suspensions where the mean particle size is 2 to 3 micrometers. It's a broad size range. So there were some particles carrying viruses that are smaller than a micrometer and some that are larger. The physical removal efficiency of all 3 viruses we tested, the 2 coronaviruses and influenza, was in excess of 99%. Which is consistent with its physical collection efficiency performance for particles in general. Then the overall removal efficiency was at least an order of magnitude better than that. So 99.9% or higher. And then for the influenza, it was approaching 99.99%. That would mean that 1 out of every 10,000 viruses passing through the device remains viable. And the other 9,999 are either collected or rendered non-viable by passage through the